Oh, good morning.
Could you sign here, please?
There.
Right.
Thanks. Right. Have a nice
day.
Dear Tony, I think it right that you should have the attached, and perhaps you'll find it an interesting, if painful, memento of long ago.
Mrs. Ford's will describes the item as a diary.
A diary?
It's currently with Mrs. Ford's daughter.
Veronica.
Hello.
Hello, Anthony.
Veronica and I were together.
Boyfriend, girlfriend?
Exactly, yeah.
Then in my school days,
I met my best friend.
Tony Webster.
I major in Finn.
Not long after, Veronica formed a relationship with him. And I wrote them both a very nasty letter.
What do you think you'll find in the diary?
This is horrible.
My best friend mysteriously died.
Who's to blame for this event?
Something is certainly going on.
What is it?
What was going on?
You're on your own now.
What you end up remembering isn't always what you actually witnessed.
It was an accident.
Legally, yes. Morally, no.
So what were you doing there?
We may never know the truth.
Are we going to address the fact that almost everything you've told me in the last few days, you've told me for the very first time?
What really strikes me is your total inability to see what's right under your nose, such as your daughter.
How often do we tell our own life story? Do we adjust, embellish, make sly cuts, and create a new reality? And when everything was coming off the rails, how were we to know that our lives got entwined? Forever.
Thanks so much for being here, you guys. Congratulations on the film. I thought it was absolutely beautiful, and I thought you had an amazing cast. Everybody's wonderful. And
absolutely.
You two are incredible together, and you do a wonderful job of capturing that feeling. I would imagine, I'm not divorced, but two people who care for each other and probably still have a lot of wonderful feelings, but are divorced and can't be together. You do a great job.
We've been married 3 times.
We have, in different movies.
Is that true?
Yeah.
Yeah, we were king and queen.
And queen of England once.
Yeah. The young Victoria, we were the king. And we did a film called The Good Father.
Oh, yes, that's right, but I wasn't married to you then. No.
Was it easy for you as actors to kind of fall into into those roles and know how you would play those scenes tonally, considering you've known each other for so long and have probably like a fond acquaintance for each other?
I think it's easier, yes. If you know someone, you can relax with them. That's the main thing you need when you're shooting a film, is you need to be able to feel relaxed.
We were at college together. I was a year ahead. Obviously, I'm much older. But we've come from the same background, working background, same training, so we knew each other from long but way back.
So you have a history, which is, I imagine, is incredibly beneficial for two characters constantly sort of coming up against their history in every scene.
You use everything you've got, really, to make a screen relationship that's fairly instant. Mm. But I also modelled it slightly on my parents, who divorced when I was young and went through quite a lot of bitterness. And then by the time, towards the end of their lives, they were very friendly. And one felt, why don't you get back together again?
Did they get back together?
Nah, they
didn't. Into it, but
sadly not.
Is this why you cast the two of them? Did you know that they had known each other for a long time and would play so easily off of each other?
Well, I knew that they knew each other because actually Jim came on board first. And I remember we spoke about Harriet in one of our early lunches, and that's when the script was just going out to Harriet. But I didn't know they'd been married 3 times. Divorce is much easier than being married 3 times, so I guess that's why it works. But I knew they knew each other well, and from the first day on set, that relationship was there. And then there's a lot of, especially when I was sitting down and editing the film, that's when you really sort of piece it together. In these performances, there were such wonderful nuances, like like the kind of wine connoisseur she is comes through in certain takes in a scene, and how ignorant of wine he is, and then also when she starts learning more about Veronica, and in that same scene she talks about the camera that he gave her, the first camera, and then when we pieced the film together, I think one of the people on the team said that, well, it's funny that Tony took up the camera from Veronica, but he didn't take the wine from Margaret, and how much she feel about that. So it was all these little things kind of came together, their history, the things, the nuances they got. It was really serving what we were trying to do with the story.
Talk about what made you take on this project. It's a novel that won, I think, the Man Booker Prize, right? A fairly prominent novel from a few years ago by Julian Barnes. What made you want to make it into a film?
Well, I really came to the project for love of the book. I've been a big lover of the book and of Julian Barnes. But when the script came to me, Nick Payne had done some really nifty and interesting things with it. Because the lovers of the book know it's not a readily adaptable book. It's Tony's first person, address to the audience.
It's very much him sort of recounting and thinking
eternal.
About his memories. Yeah.
But Nick had already done some very ingenious things, like he'd created the character of Susie that doesn't quite exist in the book. He had given Tony the camera shop. And then I met Nick, and I thought this was going to be a wonderful collaboration. And then as we started working together, he agreed with me that we needed to bring it closer to the book more so. Because actually both of us, both Nick and I, were involved in this for love of this material. But that's how I got involved. I got involved after there was already a first draft. But what really got me interested in it was that, that it's such an internal story, and we had to tell it through relationships. And I was very curious about how we were going to do that, how we were going to sort of build these worlds, and how we were going to tell this internal story through relationships. It was the challenge of it, but definitely the themes of loneliness and a coming of age story of sorts of older people, which is what I made one before this one too, which was kind of similarly a coming of age story of older people. So it was just sort of the attraction for that kind of material.
It's so weird. We only attribute the phrase coming of age stories to movies for the most part about children or adolescents or teenagers, but in actuality, most movies are kind of coming-of-age movies. There is a sense of growth and a chapter of learning. And specifically, I think in a story like this, no one ever thinks of someone in their 50s or 60s coming of age. Is that what excited you about doing the part?
It is, yeah. I mean, and I love the juxtaposition of the school days and the current age he's at, which is mid-60s. And realizing that actually he is still as troubled and as anxious and as lost as the schoolboy he was. You get older, but you don't necessarily get wiser or more grown up. I mean, young people should realise that we're not that smart a lot of the time.
Well, so much of his learning experience is about the sort of realization that he's not the centre of a world or of the world, which I love that it's just a minor change by the time
he thinks he's the center at the beginning. He's very pleased with himself, very happy with his divorce, best thing he ever did, all that, and then that is exposed as actually he's lonely and he's lost and he's looking for something else, which is this, in this case it's the ex-girlfriend who relationship which didn't last, but he's actually rather desperate, I think, but he doesn't know that at the beginning. He's quite smug about his life at the beginning.
Talk about crafting the script with Nick and adapting it from the book, because I love that you use the language of the book sparingly. And I mean, literally using it. You sort of bookend the film with what would be the sort of first-person narration, which is like a wonderful homage, but also a great way of not sort of being totally tied to being literary.
Sure. Julian always told us from the first meetings, go ahead and betray me. Julian Barnes is a novelist. And we didn't totally betray him, I think, but we actually shot a lot of scenes, especially from the school days that are in the script and shot, which have a lot of Julian's prose. And that was the toughest part in the edit, because movies are crafted on the editing table. getting rid of those scenes, because Julian also does it for good reason. He does it to build up Tony's estimation of Adrian, because those words are coming from Adrian. And in when we were putting this movie together, that was the hardest thing for us to do, because we found when we were editing it, with the way Tony, the young Tony, is looking at Adrian, that was there. So we could just do it with a look in a scene, and we didn't need the whole passage from Adrian. So that was the hardest part for me, to get rid of Julian's prose.
So you had intended to have those passages, and you realized in the editing that you didn't need them.
Yeah, a lot of the passages that the readers love, you know.
It did happen. Even I remember in some of our scenes that I thought, this is a bit too wordy. I mean, it came straight from the book, but it works on the page. But when you can actually see people's thoughts, there are lots of lines you don't need, and that somehow make it seem less intimate or less natural. And so we kind of fined it down some of the time. I weeded some of the lines out.
It's kind of the constant push and pull of, you know, at what reads properly on the page for people in a script so that they get everything that's happening doesn't necessarily work or is over the top when you start shooting and editing.
Sure. But, you know, I think also what I also learned from this movie, and Nick and I would talk about it all the time, from the early days we started working together, is that the difference between the book and the movie, the book is so strongly in Tony's, it's in Tony's voice, the book. And Tony has a realization at the end of it. He didn't know something and then he knows something. But, you know, movies have to be slightly different, where movies are really about deep-seated needs that people didn't know they had. And over the course of the movie, they realize they have this need. Like his need to, you know, meet Veronica, follow her, find out what happened, get closure for that chapter of his life. And we were talking about this yesterday. It was funny. It came up in a discussion that, funnily enough, Nick and I had always said that, well, the reason Tony has opened this camera shop is that he's hoping, subconsciously perhaps, that Veronica is going to walk in one day into this camera shop. So he has that need that he's not aware of, and then he becomes aware of through the story. But it was such an amazing kind of the translation and all the sort of thought that went into it. It's a really seductive book, and we could have kept working on it for years. I think if there was no stopping point, we would still be, I think, editing it or shooting it or doing something with it.
I love the way that Ritesh did pick up on these little visual clues, because the book is full of little mysterious dropped hints that when you almost want to go back straight away and read the book again when you find out, you only find out the real full truth around the last paragraph of the book, really. And you want to go right back and see the whole thing again with the wisdom that you have now. And in the obviously of necessity in the film, he doesn't know all the stuff that he does know at the end, because you're taking him through the journey of discovery. Whereas at the point that the narrator writes the book, he obviously knows the full story. So it's subtly different there. And I just love the little hints, like the camera shop, which isn't in the book, kind of just being so, you know, like you've just said, I hadn't thought about that, but that he might be expecting for that woman to walk in one day, you know.
I love placing Jim in the memories as well at certain points. I have not read the book. I should have admitted that initially to you guys. But where did the idea come from? I can't imagine that was in the book, but where did the idea come from of actually placing him inside these memories for the sort of idea of how he realizes it may have been different from the way he initially remembered it?
Well, really it came from necessity, you know, being, what is the saying, necessity is the mother of invention. Yeah. Because, you know, we found also as we got closer to the shoot that we are going to have to go away from the present day Tony, from Jim's character, and go into these large flashbacks of 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 7 minutes. And it's a lot to expect from an audience.
So how do we sort of sustain older Tony?
Especially as the movie is coming to its end in the second half. And we are largely in the present day, but we are still going back. So we started thinking of what flourishes, you know, what sort of magic realist flourishes we could embellish a story with, because it is so internal. And if Tony is going into this journey into the past, let's just try some audacity. And we thought we'll shoot it, and if it doesn't work for us, we won't use it. And I remember one of the flourishes we added pretty late during, I think, the shoot, we made a script change, and Jim was very kind to come back and walk through that party for us, because it was only supposed to be young Tony walking through the party, and then we asked Jim, and he came that night just to walk through the party, I think.
Is that the party where she's sort of playing with he meets her for the first time?
Yeah. And then he meets her for the second time, I think, in the same party.
It's an incredible cast that you've assembled for this film. I'd imagine it kind of works like this. You get Jim Broadbent to sign on, and everyone says, I'm in. Do I get to do a scene with Jim Broadbent? Is that how it works?
I wouldn't have thought so.
There's a really large element of truth in that, obviously.
Yeah, absolutely. That's pretty much how it worked, I think. It was just a script out there, and then Jim read the book, and then he read the script, and we had a phone call, and then Jim came on board, and then after that, everyone in the present day story, Harriet, Charlotte, Rampling, they came on board, and then Michelle Dockery's character Susie was still sort of very amorphous, because she was on the page a very kind of hippie, yoga going, daughter. She was kind of a rebel, and when I met Michelle, it just became more grounded. The idea of Susie being less distracting from the main plot and just making the story more ordinary, and then Michelle came on board. But the casting for the younger people is what took time. Took us a long time. So it was a very interesting casting puzzle. And of course, we met a lot of actors for the part of Sarah Ford, because I think it's a very difficult part to cast. In the book, it's much older. Sarah Ford's character is much older. But when I met Emily Mortimer, and she spoke to me about Sarah Ford with so much sympathy and empathy. And
I was she's also the best, Emily Mortimer.
She's amazing. And so then we had this idea after meeting Emily of just taking away Sarah Ford's youth, making her a more sympathetic character, you know, giving her a much older husband and much older kids than she would otherwise have, she'd be expected to have. It gave us an opportunity to look at every character with empathy. But it was a very interesting puzzle to cast. There were so many revelations that came about. And I think we were already telling the story through the casting, especially when we started meeting the younger people and seeing how they fit with the people who play the older characters.
Jim, I'm curious. I told you in the green room that I love Mike Leigh films, some films that you've been in, and I'd be remiss if I didn't ask you a question about it, because anyone who comes on this stage that's been in a Mike Leigh film and I'm on the stage, I have to ask a question. What's it like for you to sort of go through that process with Mike Leigh and Life is Sweet and other films early on in your career where you're building characters from the ground up, you're improvising a lot of the story for months on end, and then you go and shoot a kind of outline of a script that you've built. I believe that's kind of the process. Going from that to shooting a scheduled movie where you're following a script very closely and you haven't been doing, 7 months of kind of preparation.
Well, Mike's way of working is initially, when you first start working with him, it's fascinating, and it's a really meticulous sort of university course, almost, in acting and the structure of character and structure of dramas and pieces, because you're there for the build-up of the whole story. And that informs certainly the acting side of it, informs all the other work you do, to a degree. But that is all just a way. His way of working is a way to get a script, and when you after the ninth Mike Leigh project, the process is actually when you're no longer intrigued by the process because you've done it so often, it's actually very time consuming and not very interesting, and so it becomes harder and harder to do it. But the actual coming to a regular written script is a delight, and because you haven't got to do the work of and the writers have done the research, but it's all part of the same game. You've still got to make it real, make it sound as real as you can.
Does it help inform the work that you do when you come to a script now that's already been written?
It's bound to have done. Everything informs your work, but not consciously. I don't think now. How would Mike Leigh have approached this, or how would I approach this in a Mike Leigh sort of way? You don't do it consciously at all, but everything you do informs your next piece of work. And that probably more so than most, I suppose, yeah.
I think it's quite helpful for an actor to understand how a script works, you know, and you do learn by doing it. But at the same time, I should imagine that process makes you very aware of what, because as far as I know, you know, you can go deeply into your character as a Mike Lee actor and not be, and end up on the cutting room floor or have three lines, because it's an interesting process where you think you're the center of your universe and you're the center of your story, but someone out there, i.e. Mike Lee, is actually deciding which way the story's going to go, and he sort of follows this stream and not that stream, and you've put in just as much work playing as a, I don't know, some part that then finally doesn't end up in the story. And because we do get cut from films and we do get sort of think that that happens, we're not in control of that, you know, how it's going to end up. It's quite useful to learn those lessons and to see and understand why actually they don't need my character. They're right. They didn't need that scene. And so you don't take it personally. You realize that it's making a better overall story. You still cry, but you understand why it happened.
Let's open up to the audience for some questions. Who has questions out here?
Hello. I wanted to know if any one of you have ever had difficulty detaching yourself from a character after the project's over.
The very first Mike Lee play I did, I got because of his way of working.
Which play was that, if you don't mind me asking?
It's called Ecstasy.
Okay.
And that was on stage. That was a... And I got, and his whole way of working so obsessed me and so surprised me. I took that character home a lot, and I was living on my own then, so I didn't have to bore anyone else with it when I got home. But I did get far too involved with it. Nowadays, you can switch off at the end of the working day, quite readily. But to start, I think when you're younger, it's far more important to you in a way, and you get stuck into it and passionate about it, and it hangs around longer.
I think when I'm preparing a role, I get very involved and don't want to be distracted and want to follow every single bit of my imagination and walk through the streets of London as if I am that person or whatever it is. But when the cameras start to roll or when I'm on the stage, by that time it's just a switch I can pull and come in and out of.
Yeah.
And kind of like trust that you've done enough research for yourself that when you pull the switch, it'll be good.
It'll be there.
Next question, right here.
I'm so excited to meet both of you. As you can hear, I have a vested interest because I'm from the same place as you, although I live here. And I love when a movie brings a slice of something so British here. And it's funny, when I come out of the movie, I go, oh my God, I'm still in New York, how weird. And I did read the book and I stopped myself and I actually haven't read the end of it because I don't want to spoil it. So, and I've seen you in lots of movies, Jim, it's so exciting. So I just wondered if there's any role that's still out there for you to play. I mean, have you ever played romantic lead or any, you know, now we're all, doesn't matter about age anymore.
Yeah, I've done a romantic lead or two. The Weekend with Lindsay Duncan. The romance was slightly tetchy, but I think...
It was quite romantic,
It was romantic, yeah. Really. Yes, they did get romantic in the end. No, I never know what... There's nothing I want to do, but I hope there'll be something. I like it when other people come up with ideas. I don't have any myself. Really.
Yeah, it's easier for guys, I have to say. We women have to start looking at my age, certainly. I'm really trying to take on board that if I want to have the role I want, I'm going to have to try and create it with somebody, a writer, or because they don't just come to you as a woman and B as an older woman. They're just not out there. So you have to kind of think very hard about what you want to do. But I'm like Jim. I'd rather somebody else came to me and said, I see you as this, you know, because I don't want to make a film I've already thought of. I want a surprise. So if there are any young screenplay writers out here, just get thinking about how your, you know, what your grandmother might be really like.
Having said what I said, when a few years ago there was a diamond heist in Hatton Garden, or carried out by five 60-year-old, 70-year-old gangsters. And when that happened, everyone was saying, oh, they're bound to make a film of this. And I thought, yeah, hope they come to me if they do. And they have, so I'm going to...
You just look like a criminal, that's your trouble.
It's like you, Michael Caine, Morgan Freeman, like what's the cast?
That's that sort of, certainly Michael Caine.
Michael Douglas, maybe. Yeah. Last question.
Hey, Ritesh, so I saw that you did another feature film before this, Lunchbox, and then you have another one coming out with Robert Redford, and some short films before that. How do you pick the films and that you're working on, and what type of stories are you looking to tell?
Well, it's not like I'm flooded with a lot of offers or choice, but Lunchbox was my first film, and I carried it on my back for many years, 4 years, I think, between when I wrote it and when we were on set making it. And of course, I was rewriting it always as if, you know, it was some kind of diamond I was polishing, but also with the knowledge that it may never get made. And then after I made Lunchbox, I sat and wrote another feature for myself that I wanted to make in Bombay, because I got into a very nice writing groove. And then this book that I loved came my way, and just the opportunity to work with these great actors and adapt that book was just too tempting to, you know, pass up. So I did that, and I really loved it. And then, you know, one thing, as with everything else in life, leads to another. And as I was wrapping up this movie, Mr. Redford had seen Lunchbox. Well, actually, he had read this book as well, and he's looking forward to seeing this movie. And I got a call from his office. Someone called and said, Robert Redford would like to speak with you. Sounds like a prank call. And then he came on the phone, and he was very generous. He said, would you read a script for me and a book? And I read it, and then we had another conversation. And we were on the same page about the material. And I told him what I would like to change in the script if I had the honor to, you know, do that. And he said, well, let me think about that. That sounds great. And then he called me back, you know, a couple of hours later and said, can you be here in 2 weeks? And by serendipity, we were just wrapping up in London the work for this movie. Then I found myself in prep. So it was always one thing leading to another. But how I would like to decide is I've learned about myself through the course of these projects. And I've been very lucky to work with people who have given me a chance to really put my hand into the script. So it's never been a situation where it's, you know, what they call a director for hire strictly, where you cannot, where you just have to go and cover a script. And also been really lucky to work with actors who are very open to just trying to find things on set, because that what's scary is when you set things and you go and do that, you know, when you go and cover a script. So just having actors who have the confidence in the script and in the process that we are going to find something deeper here, something between the lines here that we haven't thought of before, that has been, you know, it's just been a bit of luck, really.
How do you... Sorry.
No, it's great to find a director who gives you time to do that, who doesn't just expect you to come with your ready-made thing and wind you up and let you go. It was a real pleasure to have that kind of a director to work with.
Yeah, yeah.
Practically speaking, how do you...
told them to say that.
Practically speaking, how do you find the time to do that? Because a film set, you know, has to make its time, has to move really fast. And a lot of times you have a lot of people who are like, why are you changing this? What? Let's go. Let's make the day. How do you find the time to sort of work the script out, maybe change it a little, find what your actors are more comfortable or happier doing and what makes the story better?
But it's been different on each movie. On some, it's been harder. And this is an intimate audience and all everyone... aside from the millions of people watching probably online. But I'll be honest, in Lunchbox, I had a great luxury. We didn't have a lot of money to make that movie. It was like a $1.2 million movie, really tiny as far as movie budgets go. But we had 4 months. We were already cast. I was already sort of friends with the actors by then, and they were all... one of them, the female lead, was coming from the theater, and she wanted to rehearse, and she wanted to tap through the pages with me over and over. So we were always, you know, embellishing it and talking about it. Irfan and I would tap through the script twice a week. I would have dinner with him. If he was stuck somewhere in Bombay traffic, he would literally tell me, look, it's going to take me 2 hours to get to my house. I'm at this intersection. I really want to tap through the script with you. This is the only time I have. Can you come and find my car and get in the car with me? And I would do that. And so it was just that 4 months of luxury we had. And then when we got on set, we didn't have to do a whole lot of that. But on this movie, it was a little bit harder. But you know, the actors were always willing. And I remember once we sat down and we spoke about a certain scene for 2-3 hours and kept the crew on standby. It's a scene in the kitchen between them. And we read, I felt like I couldn't find my way or couldn't be useful unless we had read all the scenes that in which they had been together in the movie up until that point. So we read those, some of which we hadn't shot. And then finally, we got the crew in and we shot the scene in 1.5 hours after spending 3 hours, you know, talking. So in this movie, it was a little bit harder and we got into some sticky situations because we were, or I was trying to look for things. But you know, that's the nature of this book as well. There's so much between the lines. So when even, and this was sort of, Nick and I were in agreement with, Nick the screenwriter and I were in agreement that, well, this gives us an opportunity because we were constantly working on the script and finding more things. We were like, well, there's so much between the lines here. The way to make this movie is to look for things between the lines, to look for things. Because someone was saying this about, it was a very accurate, it was, I think it was one of you who said it on the panel yesterday, just about the flatness of cinema versus the depth of literature. Because a human mind is such an amazing thing. You know, it has so many dimensions. If you're reading a deep novel, which is already a deep piece of work, like The Sense of an Ending, your mind brings an entire universe to it as well. So the experience of reading a book and watching a movie can seem pretty flat compared to that experience. So we have to build the depth through, you know, little moments like, you know, she being a wine connoisseur and him not being so. And, you know, from the performances, from the framing, from... So we were always trying to find more depth, trying to create more of that experience for an audience so they would feel like this is an adaptation of this, you know, deep book.
And I told you in the green room what I loved about the film were the things that were unsaid in the scenes. It felt like there was so much more to read into every scene, even if it was just a lighthearted comic moment. It wasn't obvious what the punchline was, or it wasn't obvious what the person was going to say next. There was always something cut out a little bit, it felt like, that made it all the more engrossing. Before I let you go, I just want to follow up on that with you guys as actors. You know, you said that you've been doing this well. You mentioned your ages. I don't have to say that. But when you're working with a director who's looking for something and he wants to rehearse with you, he wants to go over everything, do you feel like having done this for so long, you have the tools to really look at a scene quickly and be like, oh, maybe we should try it this way and this is what we can cut from here and maybe it would work better for our character? Or do you still feel like the process is kind of the same for you as it was when you started?
It's always great. What's lovely about working with Ritesh and all the other favorite directors I've worked with is that they love actors and they love what actors bring to it. So if we can act it, you know, we can contribute and have ideas and, you know, say... It's very clear when you have a line you can't really say, and so you have to pass that on to the director. You know, this doesn't quite work. Grammatically, it's awkward. It doesn't quite fit with the character I've built up that he would... So all that conversation happens, and 19% of the time, you're working with directors who are open to that, and it's very much part of the enjoyment of the job.
I have learned to try really hard, as much to understand my character and the scene and the other actor, but to know what the director's vision is. Because if it's all going to be on the screen in their vision and finally edited and cut by them, there's no point going off on your track and wanting 100 things to be packed into it that just aren't there. So. A lot of the thing is like a real, in our case, three-way conversation where you're really listening out for clues on what everybody else wants and trying to put your message into that rather than try and pull it over to somewhere that doesn't fit, which, you know, makes it very spontaneous. And, you know, you didn't come in with a plan. You just came in with an open mind, you hope.
Absolutely. Guys, I love the film. Thank you so much for being here. Tesh, how can people see The Sense of an Ending? When does it open?
It opens on March. I've practiced this plug. I wasn't so good at this on Monday. It opens on March 10th in New York and LA and goes nationwide on March 17th. And here in New York, it's going to be at the Landmark Sunshine and at the AMC Lowe's Theater on the Upper West Side. And I will be at Q&A's on Friday and Saturday at the Sunshine and out there.
This guy's going to be at Q&A's. Guys, thank you so much for being here.